Today I have a recent release from Cadison, which looks very much like a homage to one of my favorite watch designs, Taekhoe Aquaracer. From initial impression, there is a resemblance, however, at more detailed inspection there are some differences, and after pricing it at around $65, it looks like Cadison had to cut some corners. And not just figuratively speaking, I mean it literally. So, what is the resulting product, how is the quality, and what corners did Cadison cut? Well, we have it here, so let's find out. Hello and welcome back. This is one of the watches that I mentioned in my recent recommendation video, and there is more to come, so don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss any upcoming reviews. Now, when I talk about the price, I am referring to the price that I captured on my AliExpress app during the AliExpress back-to-school sale. The normal price for this watch is somewhere around $80. The prices on AliExpress do change like weather in May, so keep that in mind. And for a full disclosure, Cadison did send me this watch for review and I don't have to send it back. Hence, you probably saw the pop-up at the start of this video. And of course, there will be a link in the description of this video to the product listing. So, there are not a lot of Taekhoe homages on AliExpress, so when Cadison offered to send this watch for review, I was quite excited. Really, there are only so many Submariner homages one collection can take. Taekhoe Aquaracer has an interesting history, and one day I hope to make a video about it, but to give you a short overview of what I'm talking about, here is an Aquaracer Grand Daddy, a Hoya 844 Morning. Probably looks familiar, so as the story goes, a Taekhoe Aquaracer was heavily inspired, or strongly influenced, should we say, by Rolex Submariner, a homage, so to speak. Yes, Swiss were homaging Swiss and still do way before some of the watch factories in Shenzhen, China were even built. So, this is a note for those super aggressive commentators on my videos who have something to say about homages coming from China these days and completely ignoring ones coming from Switzerland or Germany. But I digressed. So, back to Aquaracer. What initially started as a heavily Submariner-inspired watch morphed into a pretty unique and almost instantly recognizable distinct Taekhoe-owned design, which, irrespective of what you think about Taekhoe as a company, is still very, very popular. And this is the reason that I was actually quite excited when I saw that Cadison did its own spin on Aquaracer looks, and I think they did a pretty good job here. Okay, like I said, they did cut some corners, however, this will be one of those videos where we will need to keep in mind the price tag of this watch. Just to put this in perspective, the normal price, that is, the price without discounts or specials for the NH35 movement that powers this watch, is around $30 to $35 alone. Dimensions. Okay, here are the measurements. We have a 40.2mm bezel diameter and about 40.7mm or 41-ish mm case width. Because the case has a bit of an angular shape on the side, it is tricky to pinpoint the exact case width, but I hope you get the picture. Case height is 12.7mm and it is kind of normal height for a diver case with NH35 movement in it. Lug-to-lug distance is also well managed, only 47.5mm, very compact actually, and with inverted endlings we have pretty much most wrist sizes covered from about 6 inches and up. We have 20mm lugs here, so a classic 40 diameter by 20mm lugs proportions, and the bracelet has a nice taper down to about 18mm at the clasp, which is about 20mm wide. On a fully supplied stainless steel bracelet, this watch weighs 163 grams and adjusted to my about 7-inch wrist to have a weight of 150 grams, pretty much a Goldilocks weight for an automatic desk diver. And the supplied stainless steel bracelet should cover up to 8.25-inch wrist, or about 21 centimeters in circumference. Case. We have a good quality and consistent finishing here. Pretty much most of the top of the case has a satin brushing, which I like, so the case is not a fingerprint magnet. Caddison did apply high polished finish on the four ridges of the rotating bezel and on a chamfer around the bezel, which I think was very tastefully done and gives a nice light play, especially if you take this watch outside in a sunny weather. The bezel has 120 clicks and it is unidirectional, and we will look at the bezel in more detail shortly. The transitions between the case surfaces are well defined and crisp, and yet there are no sharp corners. Also, I like how lugs curve down for a better wrist comfort. We have a side screw-down crown, which is protected by crown guards. The crown is of a good proportion and is easy to grip and operate. The rear of the case is mirror polished, and we have a well done screw-on case back with key specification highlights engraved on the perimeter and a diving helmet in the center. Okay, as far as execution goes, I like it. However, I think Caddison could use a bit more imagination here. Still, the execution is really good and we get 200 meters of declared water resistance, so a very practical timepiece indeed. Movement. As I mentioned a bit earlier, we have a robust and reliable Japanese Seiko NH35 caliber powering this watch. It is a very popular movement, especially for micro-brand divers. Here are the key specifications. We have about 41 hours of power reserve, it beats at 21,600 vibrations per hour, and it is hackable. That means that the second hand will stop when we adjust the time. Generally, I think it's a good choice of movement by Caddison here. So, Caddison specified a sapphire crystal here, and yes, the checking does confirm that we've got sapphire crystal. It is perfectly flat, the crystal sits ever so slightly proud of the bezel, literally a fraction of a millimeter, which is good because it will reduce the risk of scratching the stainless steel surface of the bezel. Also, according to Caddison product listing, we have an anti-reflective coating here. To be honest, I have seen more effective AR coatings, however, it looks like there is still some on this crystal because the legibility is pretty good at almost any viewing angles. Also, the AR coating does not have a usual bluish hue, or at least it is not as pronounced, which is good because it is not always to everyone's taste. Dial. Okay, Caddison delivered a very clean execution here. Caddison offers this watch in three colorways, and I went with this gray one. The background has a yacht deck board pattern, which features a subtle but quite nice sunburst effect. We have an applied hour indices with high polished frames and the inner space filled with loom. The multifaceted indices are finished well and balance the light nicely. Apart from the applied indices, everything else on the dial is printed. We have printed minute chaptering, printed logo, a printed text above 6 o'clock hour marker, and printed Japan movement at the bottom of the dial. I like the bevel edges on the date window cut out, it gives the date window a nice and finished look. We have multifaceted sword style hands in a similar style to the hour indices. The hands are also well executed and well proportioned, and as we will see in a moment, also like the hour indices are well filled with loom. I like the yellow accents on the second hand tip, which complements the yellow font on the wording of the dial. I like the quality of the execution that Caddison delivered here. I reviewed a few Caddison watches in the past, and their dial execution level is consistently very good. Now, before we look at the loom footage, like I mentioned at the start of the video, we need to remember the price point of this watch. The loom is actually okay and it will provide a sufficient level of legibility in the dark, however, it is unlikely to win any loom awards. Still, I think it is not bad considering the price point. Bracelet. Okay, we have a nice oyster-style bracelet, we have solid end-links, the end-links are also inverted, which definitely helps with snug fit of this watch on the wrist. Also, I like the integration of the case and the end-links, the finishing is very similar and the links are sculpted to fit almost seamlessly between the case lugs. Good attention to detail here. The stainless steel bracelet links are also solid and well finished with brushed top and mirror polished sides for a nice premium look. The links also are slightly curved and machined on the inside to ensure a comfortable fit around the wrist. We have pins connecting the links, which is perfectly acceptable at this price point, and we have a double pusher milled scissor clasp. The clasp is well executed, it has only pressed outer shell, although I like the finishing with combination of brushed outer part with a mirror polished sides and chamfer to continue the finishing pattern of the rest of the bracelet. The tolerances on the bracelet are okay, not the tightest I came across, however, perfectly acceptable at this price point, in my opinion. And while I'm happy with the clasp finishing and functionality, I'm not entirely convinced by only two micro adjustments. Basically, we have only 4 mm of adjustability to play here, which is not ideal. So, yes, this is actually the first proverbial corner that Cadison cut on this watch. Still, I like the bracelet, and once adjusted, it is very comfortable on the wrist. Here is this watch on my about 7-inch wrist. Bezel. Okay, to Cadison's credit, they did cover all the bases here, so to speak. So we have 120 clicks unidirectional bezel with a well-loomed peep, as we would expect from a diver watch with 200 meters of water resistance. We also have a good visual appearance. I like the combination of radial brushing and mirror-polished ridges on top of the bezel. Combined with a high-polished bevel and engraved markers, it creates a very aesthetically pleasing appearance. So far so good. However, here we come to those literal corners that I referred to at the start of this video that have been cut by Cadison. And I am talking about the corners on the bezel. To see what I mean, we need to take a closer look at the Tag Heuer bezel. It has corners, because it is a rotating bezel and we need some kind of a grip. Well, we don't have those corners on this watch. Not the end of the world, because we still have the four ridges, and we also can grip the bezel by slightly pressing on the brushed top of it. So, a slight compromise in design, I guess, in favor of aesthetics, but still a workable grip. However, possibly to accommodate a slightly lesser grippiness, is that the word, of the bezel, Cadison also made the bezel action a bit on the light side. So, to summarize, we have a harder to grip bezel, however, to compensate, the bezel resistance is not very strong. So it kind of works. This is, however, not the end of the bezel story. Possibly due to a low resistance, the bezel action is not the best I handled. It is okay, nice and ratchety, but there is a little backplay. Not too bad, but it is still there. And also, it does look to me that the loom peep is not perfectly aligned with the dial 12 o'clock marker. I mean, it is almost there, and yet it looks like there is a slight kink to the left. I guess this is the area where Cadison decided to homage Seiker, which is notorious for bezel misalignment, even on watches priced above $1,000. So, what's my verdict? Well, after spending a few days with this watch, I really enjoyed the aesthetics of it and the build quality. It is very comfortable on the wrist, possibly a combination of well-sculpted case, the bracelet and weight of 120 grams makes it so nice and easy to wear. And all this for a sale price of around $65, or even under $80 as this watch priced normally. I think it is still a very compelling package. However, the bezel, while looking really good in my opinion, somewhat lets this watch down. Again, not a deal breaker for me at this price point, and if you are not intending to do any hardcore diving with this watch, this is a perfect practical desk diver that will look great in the office and can go swimming with you as well. So, what are your thoughts? Please do let us know in the comments. And as always, if you find this review helpful, don't forget to hit that like button and, of course, subscribe if you haven't already done so. And as always, thank you for watching, take care, and I'll see you in the next one.